Welcome to Justin's Morning Coffee. So, today I want to talk about my book, How to Film Truth. People sort of ask me occasionally to give a summary of what it's about kind of what I think is the message that I'm trying to get across with this. This was born out of many years of attending the Sundance Film Festival, which was with the Windrider Forum. I was volunteering with the Windrider Forum, which was an organization that brings people of faith, various faiths, together with artists, specifically filmmakers, for chats and dialogues, kind of a forum for that. And I started to notice that documentary films had a real profound effect on a lot of people. And I get this with the students as well. When I teach a documentary film course in college, the students will often say that they never really considered documentary to be that significant of an impact in their lives, but after the course, they found it to be very profound. And I was kind of trying to figure out what that was all about. You know, what makes a documentary film good? So the real question is, when it comes to documentary film, or any film really, is how do you define success? You know, is it money, popularity? I asked this question to my students at the beginning of this lecture this portion of the class, and a lot of times they'll say something like, when I ask what defines the success, if you were to make a film, what would need to happen in order for you to consider it a success? And they'll say, well, maybe if it affects even one person, if it emotionally impacts one person. And someone else might say, well, it needs to be somewhat popular. I mean, you have to consider that if more people see it, that's more of a success, And then if you want to make another one, or if you want this to continue, if you want it to be sustainable, then you would need to have some money, right? I want to maybe talk about this last one, healing for the subjects. That's a big one. A lot of people think that's just an ethical question, but I happen to think that you can kind of adopt this idea that if you're going to make a film about someone, that you hope and you do everything in your power to try to make sure that that person is better off after having gone through the process of the film. And 9 times out of 10, more often than not, I want to make the case to you that the really, really good ones have a kind of a healing quality to them for embarking on the journey, both for the artist and for the subjects. This is a film called Grey Gardens, which was in the 1970s, the Maisels brothers, and it was incredibly successful on all levels, right? It was healing for the subjects involved. Just go look up Grey Gardens, and you'll see what I mean. There was a Broadway play that was made years later, really struck a chord with a lot of people. There was a movie with Drew Barrymore that was a fictional film of Grey Gardens was made out of the movie. It was successful in every way, and the subject of the film, she wound up having a career on Broadway, singing after the film was over. So there's a lot of sense that because these filmmakers went into their lives of these two women, the subject of this film, everyone was sort of better off. And so I want to explore that a little bit. Oops. This is a film called Let There Be Light. This is John Huston down here, famous filmmaker. But during the war, during World War II, he was actually commissioned to make films for the War Department. There was famously, lots of Hollywood directors that went on to have massive careers who made films for the U.S. government to boost morale. Really, they were propaganda films. But this particular film called Let There Be Light was something that changed the life of John Huston ever after. And I want to talk a little bit about that. I'm going to show you the trailer for something on Netflix called Five Came Back. And this really kind of shows you the legacy of these filmmakers that made films for the War Department to kind of help you understand the context of what I'm about to propose about John Huston.
"Stop thinking and follow me," cried Hitler. "I will make you masters of the world."
A lot of people laughed. He was a clown, but they weren't so evil. It was a comedy.
America stands at the crossroads of its destiny.
In the early years of Hitler's rise, moviegoing had become an essential part of American culture. But Americans did not realize the extent of the threat Hitler posed.
He understood cinema could be put in the service of propaganda.
Americans realized we can't win this war. These guys are gonna beat us.
Western civilization was at stake, and we're going to fight until we win.
Five filmmakers wanted to respond as so many millions of men and women responded. They chose to serve.
These documentaries were powerful for American audiences.
The footage proved that the enormity of the task was worth it.
We had an enormous story to tell. The greatest heroes, the greatest villains on the world stage.
This was real filmmaking.
This is the people's war. It is our war.
These five men, they were saying goodbye to families who never knew.
So that's just to give you a little sense of the context, right? So John Huston was making, let me skip ahead here, this film at the end of the war. Called Let There Be Light, and it was following these soldiers who would have what we would call now PTSD, or during World War I they called it shell-shocked, you know, but this idea that while you may not be physically harmed, that the wartime experiences could cause you to be psychologically harmed. But this, here's a quote from John Huston that I find very telling. He had experienced a PTSD of his own. He had been near conflict in his service in the war, and he was going through something, the aftermath of something traumatic. And he said this, "Of making Let There Be Light with Army veterans suffering from PTSD after experiencing the horrors of war, director John Huston described the whole process as, quote, an extraordinary experience, almost a religious experience." Now, I got the chance to talk to Danny Huston, his son, when I was working on set one day, and he confirmed that that this was a kind of a turning point in the life of his father. An interesting thing happened. The veterans in this veteran hospital that were subjects of the film had a higher discharge rate than the veterans that did not participate in the film. A small sample size, I know, but very interesting idea that maybe the filming, maybe the making of the film had something to do with their psychological recovery. I'm going to show you just the beginning of the film so that you can kind of get a sense of what it was like, what the film was like.
Thank you. The guns are quiet now. The papers of peace have been signed. And the oceans of the earth are filled with ships coming home. In faraway places, men dreamed of this moment. But for some men, the moment is very different from the dream. Here is human salvage, the final result of all that metal and fire can do to violate mortal flesh. Some wear the badges of their pain, the crutches, the bandages, the splints. Others show no outward signs, yet they too are wounded. This hospital is one of the many for the care and treatment of the psychoneurotic soldier. These are the casualties of the spirit, the troubled in mind. Men who are damaged emotionally, born and bred in peace, educated to hate war, they were overnight plunged into sudden and terrible situations. Every man has his breaking point, and these, in the fulfillment of their duties as soldiers, were forced beyond the limit of human endurance.
Howdy, man. On behalf of the commanding officer and his staff, Mason General Hospital, I want to extend a hearty welcome to all of you on your return to the United States. There's no need to be alarmed at the presence of these cameras, as they're making a photographic record of your progress at this hospital from the date of admission to the date of discharge.
Here are men who tremble, men who cannot sleep, men with pains that are nonetheless real because they are of mental origin, men who cannot remember, paralyzed men whose paralysis is dictated by the mind. However different the symptoms, these things they have in common. Unceasing fear and apprehension, a sense of impending disaster, a feeling of hopelessness and utter isolation.
May I have your last name? How do you spell that? M-E-I-S-E-R.
May I have your last name, please?
Bolivar.
And your
W-O-L-A.
How do you
spell
that?
The psychiatrists listen to the stories of the men who tell them as best they can. The names and places are different. The circumstances are different. But through all the stories runs one thread. Death and the fear of death.
And then after you got wounded, what happened? Same thing, only worse?
Seems like my nerves keep getting worse, though.
They get worse.
These airplanes, they bombed.
Yeah.
I got killed nearly from one.
You nearly got killed? Where were you at the time?
St. Louis, I believe. I don't remember.
And what were you doing when the planes came over?
I was in a hole. Hmm?
You know where you are?
I think I'm in the States now. They told me I was coming back.
Right.
But they told me I was going to die. On the hospital, I wouldn't eat hardly.
No,
I was sick. And I wouldn't eat hardly. They told me I was going to die, but then he couldn't help me.
Well,
told me they didn't care where I died or not.
We will see that you don't die. You won't die.
I'm going to skip ahead a little bit here so you can see another interview taking place.
Have you been getting along?
well. Fairly well, sir.
Mm-hmm. You overseas?
Yes, sir.
Where?
We were in France, and then we went to Germany.
In where?
France to Germany.
Oh. And what outfit were you with?
I was with Headquarters Detachment, 50th Quartermaster Battalion Mobile.
Mm-hmm. I see your PFC.
At present, sir.
You went, had you go in the hospital?
Sir?
You had to go in the hospital?
Twice, sir.
It says here on your record from overseas that you had headaches and that you had crying spells.
Yes, sir. I believe in your profession is called nostalgia.
In other words, homesickness.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
It was induced when shortly before the war I received a picture of my sweetheart.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I can't continue.
That's all right. Rip it.
Yes, sir.
Come on, sit down a minute.
So you can see the emotional impact of this. First of all, there was some kind of an effect on the subjects in the film. The fact that there was attention paid to the subjects. And that sense of emotion, that sense of revealing something in a film, you know, is actually quite common. When I go to Sundance, people will often say that the interviews felt like therapy sessions. So there's some kind of an overlap between therapy and this particular art form. Now it might not seem like a surprise to you, but the War Department did not allow this film to be released. It basically suppressed it. The quotes are quite astonishing, where you know certain high levels in the Army said that it makes American boys look like namby-pambies or something, you know, like the American boys have backbone, they're not weak, right? That was the sentiment at the time. And it wasn't until, you know, really the 1980s that film finally was released. However, you wouldn't say, I don't think you would say, or I don't think John Huston would say, that the film was not a success because it had a healing effect on him and it had a healing effect on those involved. So maybe there's something about the process of documentation that's valuable, even, you know, outside of whether or not anyone sees it, whether or not an audience sees it. Werner Herzog, one of my favorite documentarians, calls it filmmaking as a journey on foot. It's about the process of exploring the world. So I think that's something to consider. Here's a great example of this sort of healing effect. It illustrates what I think Stephen Pressfield in a book called The War of Art talks about, where, you know, when you're making art, there's a real sense that you're in a war of sorts. You're having to overcome these forces of antagonism within your life, you know, all of those things that would stop you from creating. And in the process of breaking through those things, you might discover something beautiful. Here's the trailer for My Octopus Friend.
I remember the day when it all started, seeing this really strange thing. A lot of people say an octopus is like an alien. But the strange thing is, as you get closer to them, you realize that you're very similar in a lot of ways. It's a hard thing to explain, but sometimes you just get a feeling and you know there's something to this creature that's very unusual. There's something to learn here. I had to have a radical change in my life. And the only way I knew to do it was to be in this ocean with her. And then I had this crazy idea. What happens if I just went every day?
That's the line right there. What would happen if? What would happen if I just went every day, right? This is filmmaking as a journey on foot. This is a South African filmmaker who was burnt out and lost his creative spark, didn't know what to do, started swimming in the ocean, in the cold water, snorkeling every day. And slowly, after discovering this octopus, decided, well, I'm just going to take my craft of filmmaking, take my camera, and I'm going to go and swim with the octopus every day. And it turned into one of the most beautiful films I have ever seen, right? And I can't say that he knew what was going to happen, right? He engaged in this idea of the practice, right, without necessarily knowing what the final result would be. So this is what I want to kind of pitch to you, is this idea of documentary film as a spiritual journey of sorts. Or you might be able to say filmmaking as therapy. Why am I able to pair the documentary film process? And I'm not saying it's just for documentary film, but this is the lens that I'm using. It's really for all art, I think, with a spiritual journey, right? That might get the hackles to raise on some of you for various reasons. This is a quote from a scholar named Brent S. Plate. Dig around in art and you find religion. Dig around in religion and you find art. Now, you might not think that's true, right? You might be skeptical of that, and I totally understand, right? This is a kintsugi bowl. This is a traditional bowl that I learned about from the artist in residence at the time at Fuller Theological Seminary when I was there, Mako Fujimura. And it's basically a broken bowl that is repaired with gold, right? And there's a sense that the bowl is more valuable after having been broken, right? And for Mako Fujimura, to him, that is a theological concept, you know, that that something after having been broken and then redeemed in some sense is more valuable, more complex, more beautiful after having gone through the trauma. This is below that you can see the Orvieto Cathedral, the Duomo in Orvieto. I spent two summers studying abroad in the little hilltop town of Orvieto, and within that cathedral, there's all kinds of art. There's sculpture. There's frescoes from 1,000 years ago. There's sculptures from the time of Michelangelo, Savonarola, the contemporary of Michelangelo, all the way up to the doors made by an artist in the 1960s, Emilio Greco. Right. So there's a sense that the religion was a gathering place for all of this different art, all through these different generations. So it's certainly the case that if you dig around in religion, you're going to find art, right? That's definitely the case. It's the reverse that I want to maybe, that I might need to convince you of, which is that you dig around in art and you find religion. Now, Walter Houston's not a religious person. His son, Danny Houston, didn't give me indication that his father was ever a religious person, yet he described the making of Let There Be Light as a religious experience. Okay, and I hear this all the time, all the time. People are talking about their art making as religious. What do they mean by that? That's the question I want to ask. Okay, so here's the crux of the matter. Here's what I kind of want to show. I want to say that there's different kinds of documentary film. And again, not just documentary, but I'm using documentary as my lens for this. Different kinds of different actions in the world, different kinds of truth that you are pursuing. These four are not exhaustive, but I'd like to use these four as examples. Confession, testimony, lament, and celebration. Now, really what we were looking at with Let There Be Light, that was operating in what I like to call confessional space. The truth that you're trying to get at when you're making a confessional piece, right? Confessional documentary or a confessional painting or a confessional piece of other kind of art, right? The truth that you're trying to get at is personal. It is internal. It has to do with self-knowledge, increasing in self-knowledge, okay? I like to call it a truth-telling ritual, right? So think of confession, okay? There's always a book genre, right? The confessions of so-and-so, confessions of a crime boss, confessions of this, confessions of that, right? Then oftentimes they're kind of juicy, right? But then if you go all the way back to St. Augustine, right? St. Augustine, he's got St. Augustine's confessions, right? Why did St. Augustine feel the need to write a confession to everyone? Why did he need everyone to know that he wasn't perfect, right? He was the bishop at the time, early church fathers, he wrote a very personal piece that included lots of embarrassing stuff about himself and his former life, right? What's the function of that? Why would human beings need to hear someone else confessing the things in their past? Okay, so this is an old practice. The Desert Fathers and the Desert Mothers, certain traditions of monastic traditions in prior to the Reformation involved a monk who had a confessor, right? And so the confessor was someone who you would go to in order to seek spiritual guidance by confessing. So think of it as kind of like prototherapy, right? And you know, Freud and Jung, Carl Jung and Sigmund Freud, the fathers of modern psychology, modern therapy, modern psychoanalysis, did not even disguise the fact that they were borrowing this idea of confessional practice from the church, right? Within church, within Protestantism and Catholicism, you've got personal confession that still exists, right? You've got the Catholic confessional, but then you've got corporate confession, you know, in Protestant churches where there's a reading of a confession in the service and then an absolution by the minister. And then you've got therapeutic confession, which you might say is at an all-time high. It's certainly a heyday of what Sigmund Freud wanted, which was he wanted an army of psychologists going out into the world and providing space for people to confess and to analyze and to gain in self-knowledge and hopefully become more psychologically and, dare I say, spiritually more healthy, right? Okay, so that's a long tradition of confession in literature, in art, in religion, and in therapeutic practice, okay? And documentary film that operates in confessional space is operating in the same arena, I want to say. Here's a clip from a filmmaker who describes how she encounters this need to confess from her subjects and what she does with that knowledge.
I always tell the individual person, because it always happens, we get very intimate and the person is in confidence and will say things sometime that they never said before to anyone else because of the relationship you develop with your subject. And I always say to them at first, if should it be that you say something that you feel very sorry that you said it, you tell me, and I don't have to use that. Now, the difference is, I know many people, they say, you're crazy to do this, because what if the person tells you something and, you know, you're the only one that knows it, and it's very important to the film. For me, it's never important enough for me to damage someone's life.
So, why does this happen? I mean, the subjects presumably know that you're filming them with a camera, and that camera is going to be an image that goes public at some point. It's made for the public, right? So why would people be spontaneously confessing, telling this filmmaker stuff that they've told no one else before? Never told their parents, never told their significant other, never told their closest friends, right? Why would they do that? There's a psychologist who I met at a conference one time named Kurt Thompson, and he has a very specific form of therapy, and he bases it around this idea of the need to be known. So the idea is that human beings, we're constantly lying to ourselves. We're constantly engaging in internal narratives with ourselves that may or may not be true, right? And there's a sense that when you talk through something with somebody else, you're gauging that other person's reaction, right? You're sort of seeing how it lands on them, and there's a sense that you gain in self-knowledge. You know more about yourself and your own story as you tell your story to someone else. There's certain therapeutic programs out there that are based on this idea. There's one called Opening Up by Writing It Down. And it's this idea that by writing out your story, you start to integrate all of the different parts. One of the main problems with traumatic experiences is that we tend to hide it away, and we have a narrative in our life that doesn't include that trauma, right? It doesn't include the bad parts, right? And one of the points of this kind of therapy is to take that traumatic thing and integrate it in the story, right? And it's very interesting to read how it is that people construct their narrative story, right? And how they present themselves to someone else, right? And if there's a lot of stuff in your life that you cannot present publicly, because of embarrassment or because you're suppressing it from yourself or whatever it might be, there's a lot of unhealth that sort of comes with that. And so there's a sense of working through that stuff, reintegrating it back into the narrative of your life that puts you back together in some sense, right? One thing that's important is to see yourself as working through the traumatic thing. So if your story that you tell yourself, and then consequently the story that you tell other people about yourself, is that you've encountered challenges, you've encountered adversity, you've encountered trauma, but you have come out on the other side, or you're working through it, or you are a survivor of it, There's a sense that that who you are is not defined by the trauma, right? So that's one of the dynamics, right? So it's interesting that this practice of confession, however it works, you know, however successful or not successful it is, one thing is for sure, it doesn't work if there's no one listening. It doesn't work if you just confess to yourself in your own bedroom with no one listening, right? There needs to be a listener, right? And so that's what this filmmaker, I think, was providing for her subjects, was they had never had a listener before. And so it brings up all of this stuff. And they're in their mind, they're actively reconstructing their narrative and putting their narrative back together in that maybe was fragmented, right? And she's providing the service by conducting these interviews, right? And that may have been an unintended side consequence, right? But maybe not. Maybe that is the point of a confessional documentary. So, what about us who watch it, right? We're watching someone confess. We're watching someone talk about something that is maybe uncomfortable or traumatic or something that they did wrong or mistakes that they made. What's the benefit for us, right? That's a good question. Here's a trailer from a film called Minding the Gap, which operates in the confessional space as best as I've ever seen a film operate in the confessional space. When I saw it at Sundance, I think in 2018, I was absolutely blown away by it. Anyone who watches this film is going to be absolutely blown away by it because of the closeness of the relationship between Bing Liu, the director, and these friends of his that he filmed for years, skateboarding around East St. Louis, or I think it was St. Louis, where they grew up. So I'm going to play you the trailer here, and then we'll discuss it a little bit more.
Take one.
I'm making this film because I saw myself in your story.
I always felt like I didn't fit in with my family.
My parents ran this very controlling house. I ran away a lot.
Skateboarding is more of a family than my family.
How did you get disciplined?
I mean, well, they call it child abuse now, but...
Life might be moving too fast.
We have to fully grow up and it's gonna suck.
When you're a kid, you just do, you just act. And then somewhere along the line, everyone loses that.
I knew you had some huge weight on you. Skateboarding meant more to you. It was kind of a life or death thing.
I remember hearing screaming coming from your room, and it was like really, really unnerving.
One of the last things I said to my dad was that I hate you.
You can't just have a child and abandon them. Life doesn't work like that.
I just don't want him to grow up like me. I just want to hide. I just want to run away. That's what the drinking is about.
Maybe you're right. Maybe I need to just move on.
I wish you could. I wish then it's, I could do over.
I could seriously be on the verge of having a mental breakdown, but as long as I'm able to go skate, I'm completely fine.
So, I did, you got to see the film. You really, really got to see the film. He basically follows his friends as they are navigating the difficulties of growing up. And he talks, he's able to talk about something in the film that is hard to talk about for anybody, which is something that happens in the shadows, you know, domestic violence, right? And there's a sense that in the film, you're once removed as an audience member, right? You're once removed from the actual event, right? So it's not like someone coming up to you on the street and saying, hey, you know, here's this difficult subject that I want to talk to you about, right? it's put into an arena, put into a place where we can actually kind of talk about it with relative safety, you know, with relative ease. So something's going on here. What I tell, you know, my students is, you might be an artist who operates in confessional space. You might be someone who's able to help people open up. You know, you might have a kind of a therapeutic or a priestly, you might say, demeanor, right? And in which case, I think it narrows it down a little bit in terms of the power and meaning of the piece that you're making. Does it get to confessional truth? And when you do, it's very transformative. So that's the first category that I would say is a spiritual genre. And I'm going to end the video here. And we've got a couple more categories to get through. And so check back for the next one down below.